then let's deep dive in four aspects of the standard that are interesting. So just that you know what we're going to speak of, we're going to discuss materiality again. That's an important point. We're going to discuss limited versus reasonable assurance. We're going to discuss greenwashing, impact washing, social washing, a lot of washing. And we're going to also to discuss something that is really of interest for us here in Europe, which is what do we need to add to ISA 5000 to be able to use this standard as a baseline in Europe. So a lot of very important points. But first, short introduction from each of you.
You want me to start? Okay, good. Thank you very much. First of all, thank you very much for the explanation. It was really helpful for me too. So thanks for that. In 15 minutes, you can do it, apparently. That tells us much about the standard. At Accountancy Europe, we have, of course, already looked into this and are discussing this. And I should say up front, we're really welcoming this this global standard for sustainability assurance. It is really about time with the EU now coming with the standards, but also other jurisdictions. So hopefully we get there just in time. Where we are working in this space already, of course, for a very long time, but always with either a local standard or ISAE 3000. That was a sort of standard, but quite difficult to implement in practice. So first of all, we really welcome it. Secondly, we can see that it's really been focused and dedicated to sustainability assurance, so it touches on the right points. And initially, I thought LNR is left and right, but it is limited and reasonable, I just learned. And that is also very helpful. I'm making a bit of a joke, but the issue always in assurance is what is limited assurance. We will be discussing that for another 20 years, I think, but you have really done a good job, I think, in clarifying this a little further. We will discuss it a little later, so I will not say all yet now. Is there room for improvement? Yes, there is. You have now the consultation out. We will be responding to that as Accountancy Europe. We will come up with recommendations, amongst other related to key assurance matters and limited and reasonable, but we'll get to that later. It's really, really important that we all embrace this as accountants, also as other assurance providers that are in this space, and that we get to a common base with the help of this standard. I leave it there as an introduction. Thanks.
Patrick?
Good afternoon. Please, let me first say that the things that I will tell you this afternoon are my own opinions and not those of the members of the CEOB, because we are currently in the process of preparing a comment letter to the IAASB on ISA 5000. The thing is, it's not finalized, and therefore it's very difficult for me to take a stand on a number of topics and make comments on specific things for which we have a lot of debate in the group that is working on the response to your exposure draft. But I would like to say that we are very thankful to the IAASB for the timely development of the draft standard for ED 5000. And accelerating the process was really needed because entities in Europe will have to report in 2025 on their information related to next year. Therefore, it's very, very important that we have this to work with in the coming month. So I would like really to thank the IAASB, its chair, and all the team for that.
José?
Thank you. Well, for EFAA and SMPs, our principal concern before now the standard was scalability. We are glad that the standard is based on principles, so it's easily scalable. But our concern still exist related to the future standards that will be issued in order to define or improve the way. And also it's important for us the proportionality in the use of the standard, especially related to small enterprises which have not the information systems as big groups, and also in the value chain that will be necessary to report to bigger clients. And this could be complicated to deal with, as sometimes happens in financial with groups. Those are the main concerns for the small practitioners.
Thank you. And Mark, last but not least.
First, thank you for the invitation of participating to this roundtable. You introduced me as an IASP, which means Independent Assurance Service Provider, which is a nice word, but it means otherwise non-audit firms pretending offering assurance services to companies, and it is precisely what we pretend to do. As you know, I represent more than Bureau Veritas, but a global sector entering into this new activity. In a few words, to let you know that our sector offers since more than 35 years audit to our clients, mainly related to management systems, but also to the supply chain. Since at least 10 years, we do deliver assurance services, mainly on non-regulated markets, as you clearly introduced it. And today, our approach is to benefit from all this dynamic around the CSRD and the ESRS at first, but also ISA 5000, with the intention to align our practices to the profession practices, as we do believe that we should have a single common way of proceeding with audits, whatever is the track records of the auditors and the firms participating to it. But again, thank you for the invitation.
Thanks, everybody. So maybe now we can start by key aspects of the standard and a key aspect of sustainability assurance and assurance at large, which is materiality. So we have the materiality of the preparer. Here in Europe, it's a little bit specific because we have this double materiality concept that is new to everybody. And we have the materiality of the practitioner that I have presented previously with this challenge of assessing materiality on qualitative information. So I will let you the floor to discuss the challenge of materiality and how you see that. And maybe Wim, if you want to start on that.
Yeah, thanks. I think you already said it in your 15 minutes, like, unfortunately, we use materiality in different respects. So with that that as a given, I think that that materiality process is, of course, critical to every report and therefore also critical for the auditor. So what I mean to say with that is also, like, if you are an auditor, call it like what is in the report is not so interesting. It's always interesting what is not in the report, because that's where companies are, you know, may erroneously reporting and therefore misinform stakeholders. So that process is really critical for every audit process also. Now, the challenge is, first of all, with that process is, do you take process or do you add content knowledge, right? And we auditors are very good at looking at processes, but you may have a perfect process but a bad outcome. So I think you need here knowledge, right? You need content of what is this about. If you look at the standards, it talked about understanding the entity, and that also alludes, of course, to understanding the material matters. That is, I think, very good in the standard. Still, I would personally believe that there could be more on specifically this process, because we should not underestimate how new this is to most of our auditors around the world, right? So it is, I think, very important to highlight that a little more in the report. Then also, when you then look at limited versus reasonable, there's not really a reference to what extent or how deep you should look at the materiality process. And there again, I think it would really be helpful to add some more in the standard itself. Then you talked on the other two materialities, the planning and the performance. The planning is relatively easy, but the performance is very challenging, and particularly with respect to the disclosures. So if you look at the quantitative side, I think that is a challenge because I've been an assurance provider myself, so we always set it at like 5%. But what does that mean in reality? What does it mean for your procedures? How deep do you then really go, and how can you substantiate? That is a real challenge, I think. So over time, we will learn more and more, I'm pretty sure. Then on performance materiality, it becomes even more challenging. And I think you said, I really like that. You said like, well, where it talks about, what was it again, the exact wording, but at least you said, use your brains. And that is what I really like. That is what we need, particularly for all those qualitative disclosures. The one thing I would say is when I was like for 10 years or so in the space, I started to realize that we looked at many individual disclosures. We looked at all the trees, but sometimes we forgot to look at the wood. So I think it's very important, and that is a challenge, to take a step back and say, not every individual disclosure, but the story as a whole, is this telling the real story? And how to get there, I don't think we can solve that with a standard. We need to solve that in practice and learn and maybe take some failures before we know what we need to do there. I think that is my short reflection.
I would agree that there's a lot of complexity in materiality in the topic that we're dealing with right now. Of course, there's the concept that are used that use the same words but are very different, and using this term of materiality when the CSRD is also dealing with double materiality, with the ESRS, that's something that might not help the practitioners and also the preparers. I would totally agree with what has been said about the use of the word for different concepts, the fact that there are materiality for misstatements, and to come back to what you said at the end, in particular, looking at narrative disclosures, which is something that is quite new. At least it has an importance that is much bigger than it has with financial reporting. And all the other instances where materiality is used, materiality for misstatement, performance materiality. So these are provisions that would need probably to be even further clarified, if possible, in my view, to help define more precisely the work and the expectations for the practitioners. And I think that's something that would not only help the practitioners, but also the supervisors.
Well, materiality, and especially double materiality, is a very complex concept. So in this regard, for SMPs, we need that standard setters, association, and professional bodies are coordinated in order to give the small practices information, training, guidelines, because small practices have small teams. So there are few resources in order to study and prepare materials. I think that's the main point, because materiality for a big company is the same issue as a small company. In fact, there is no scalability there. There's not much scalability. But we need to apply also the concept, and we have not the resources as a huge accounting firm have.
There is a lot to say on materiality. If I look to the undertaking materiality before looking to the assessment part of it, First, there is a big discussion between certain standards and the European standards regarding the double materiality. I believe it is a loss of time since always we have approached the assessment of sustainability risk with a double materiality approach. The new thing is ESRS has clearly defined the way to proceed with this double materiality assessment. This is particularly helpful. Second, it has highlighted clearly the three components of the outcomes of the materiality assessment, which is the impact, the risk, and the opportunities, which is new because we start speaking about opportunities. So for me, it's certainly a little complex, but extremely useful because it defines clearly what should be the focus of the company according to its activity and the impact and risk and opportunities associated to it. The other point is, well, I'm not developing too much, but regarding the assessment part of it, if I may, I think it is important for the assessor to challenge the proposition made by the company, not only the result itself, but also the process it used to prepare this double materiality, the stakeholders that have been approached, the information and the validity of the information they rely on to quantify this materiality. So there is this part which is more based on the historical process to produce this double materiality. And then he has also, my conviction is he needs to challenge the result of it, and for which we highly recommend in our sector to have in the audit team a person knowledgeable in the industry sector of the company, who knows the risk this company is exposed to, has the experience of site activities, and can, as you explained it very well, assessing is not just about processing things. Otherwise, we would have more access to artificial intelligence to do the assessment. We need the people, the experience, the analysis to highlight, to guide in the decision. So if I may recommend something, will be that, to ensure that we have in each assessment team people knowledgeable in the sector of the industry to better assess the impact of this materiality.
On that, maybe we should remind that behind the standard, even a precondition to apply the standard, you need to have standard at least as demanding, and we mentioned that, at least as demanding as the code of ethics, and at least as demanding as the quality management standard ISQM1 from IWSB. And one key aspect that you will find in these two standards are competency. You can only accept the engagement if you have a competency to perform this engagement. So having someone knowledgeable about the sector and able to challenge the materiality process of the entity is key, because you cannot accept the engagement if you don't have the competency to do so. So now maybe we will move to the next topic, which is another interesting one, and it has been something we have been struggling with many times. What's the difference between limited and reasonable assurance? So I have explained how we dealt with it in the part on risk and in the response, but it's not easy. It's not easy because when we want to deal with reasonable assurance, we have the ISAs. So they're quite mature, so we can have a look at that and see what do we do in an audit and try to see what we could do in a reasonable assurance engagement over sustainability information. And then limited assurance is something in between nothing and reasonable assurance. So we try to find the right balance. So I would welcome your views on this difference, how it has been approached, and also how we can convey it in the assurance report so that the reader can really understand what has been done and that limited is less than reasonable. And sometimes we have a perception that they may perceive the opposite.
Someone else would know, I'm fine. Okay, I go. Okay, fine. Yeah. Yeah, well, the latter, I'm a bit smiling when you say, how can we explain it in the assurance report? I think we need another page or two if we want to explain the difference. Personally, I don't believe we should really try to include it in the assurance report. The issue is we are bound to certain language in our overall standards, in our other standards, in assurance reports. And if we would want to clarify this, this becomes no longer in line, I think, with the rest of the report. So, to be honest, we looked at it yesterday, and we haven't concluded, but when I saw it again, my conclusion was, well, this is not really good, but it's the best we can get, right? And within the profession's language. If we were to redo it, we may think of something else than limited assurance, but that's another story. If you think about the differences, that is a challenge for a long time. Also in terms of how far do you go? And you had in your explanation also a reference to if you suspect that things may not be accurate or complete, then you need to do a deep dive, right? I really like that approach. When you look at the standards, there is this L and R, but also there is, for the procedures, this explanation, what do you do in limited, what do you do in reasonable? And whereas we may see further improvements and more concrete concrete recommendations, if you like, or procedures that you may do, I think it's a step forward. We started with, yeah, limited is something less than reasonable, and now at least we have, like, I don't know how many, but 20 or 30 different differences. Sometimes, a personal view here, sometimes it's a bit artificial, right? So you try to make a difference where there's no real difference, maybe, but that can all be tweaked and improved. The concern, of course, is for all auditors that are relatively or completely new in this space, how do you balance that? Where I think that stepping back to the principles and saying, is there anything here that that I would be suspicious about whether it's right or wrong? That is the principle approach I would take. You have in the standards the likely to arise, and that I think also needs some further clarification, because you now say for the reasonable assurance you need to assess it at assertion level. For limited assurance, you only need to look into disclosure where it's likely to arise potential errors or mistakes. But then comes the question: when do I think it's likely to arise? So maybe some further considerations there on what you could think of, like there is for materiality, that could really be helpful, I think, to further specify.
Who else wants to comment on limited versus reasonable assurance?
I'll jump in, though I don't think I have much to tell you that you don't already know. This is something that has always been difficult. I've spent 14 years with the AMF in France, so the market regulator, and it has always been something with which we've been struggling when looking at half-year reporting and at the full-year reporting. The expectations from the readers on the half-year financial statements were quite different from what was really done by the auditor. So this is not new. What I would like to say, and it's again a personal view, is that I'm very much like what you have done with the tables, showing the differences between what you consider to be something that is to be done with as part of a limited assurance compared to a full assurance. So thank you for that, because I think it is very helpful. And again, it's a very tough topic, and these tables, I believe, are a way to make progress in the right direction.
Thank you. So, Rosé, so in your practice, you are performing sustainability assurance engagement. Do you do limited or reasonable?
Limited, because also right now, especially for SMEs, the information system needed to report on sustainability are not well implemented. So right now, I think it's the cost of reasonable assurance is too high for small companies. And in the future, I think that the cost will be the matter in order to have an opinion of it's better for small companies report assurance limited or reasonable, because there are a lot of topics and a lot of information to check.
Mark, do your companies performing assurance engagement? Are you performing reasonable or limited assurance engagement?
No, we do both. Just a parallelism with our core activity, which is certification. Certification is very similar to reasonable assurance. Not only we assess the information which is reported, being qualitative or quantitative, but we assess all the process to build this information, the control in place, and we ensure that it is sustainable and replicable and extended to the other non-audited activities. So by art, we would recommend to go for reasonable assurance, and I fully understand that for middle-sized companies, it may represent a cost. I have two comments about that. First is moving from limited assurance, which is the standard today, to reasonable assurance, in case you recommend to move towards reasonable assurance, it will have at least two strong impacts. The first is the significant increase of the assessment time, which one will double or triple in some situations, with two effects. First, we need to have enough auditors available to provide double load of activity, which is not required today.
Competent.
And second,
dependent.
And yeah, absolutely. And second, to the cost it represents for the companies itself. And then for small companies, it is a huge cost. And I think we have to be very attentive, reducing the inflation of the cost as much as we can. Because this is the first criticism we listen in Europe, the burden of the administrative cost attached to this sustainability reporting. And I think we will all lose if at the end of the day, the conclusion is that we benefit from a situation. And I think this has to be as much as we can control. That was my comment.
Okay, thank you. So now moving to washing. So often we say greenwashing, but often when we refer to greenwashing, we have in mind only the E of the ESG, and we forgot about the other washing that may exist. So I wanted to have your view on how we have achieved in draft ISA 5000 the objective of dealing with the risk of fraud, including the risk of greenwashing, and what else we could do.
Yeah, it's interesting that you ended with the risk of fraud and greenwashing, because those are, of course, they may be somewhat close to each other, but they're definitely not the same, right? So it is really a very thin line between where I'm just somewhat positive about what I have achieved and where I start to intentionally misinform my stakeholders. So that is a thing to be said up front, and I personally see there a risk that we start with a fraud lens, if you like, but then come to the conclusion, yeah, this isn't fraud, right? So then, if it's not fraud, then it is okay. Huh? But that comes to that same trees and wood thing. Sometimes you read an individual sentence and you go like, yeah, you know, the company says, like, we have significantly improved compared to last year, right? And you can prove it with a number, and the next sentence is also somewhat positive, and then the whole story becomes just too positive. That is, I think, where we as auditors or assurance providers generally should be very careful with taking only frauds and errors and say, like, it's not a real error because you can justify, it's not fraud because it's not intentional, so therefore it's okay, right? It still cannot be okay. And if you then look at the standards again, I think implicitly it's in, right? If you read it very carefully and then it's in, you may argue whether you should include greenwashing as a term in the standards, because what is greenwashing then? What is the definition? And have we used that elsewhere too? So that comes, I think, with a lot of complications. But still, to highlight that, for example, the auditor should, during the process, take a step back and look at the process as a whole. And when it is too positive or too negative, but honestly, mostly it is too positive, to enter into the discussion with the company and make sure that you get to the right balanced story. Very important reporting principle, balance. And ingrain that into your approach. So, to the standards again, I think there can be more on greenwashing. It is all and everywhere, right? So in the EU, the greenwashing, the Green Claims Directive comes out, and you hear it all over, even now in financial papers. So it's a real issue that we need to tackle as auditors. If we fail on that, we have failed on the whole project, so to say.
Thank you. Anyone else on this washing topic?
Thank you. Quick one. I think there's something very interesting. There are some things that are very interesting in the application material. Because when talking about greenwashing, it relates to for instance, targets for climate, scenarios for analysis of climate, etc. And there you have application material dealing with forward-looking information, with information produced by the entity, and maybe there's some room for improving the level of requirements by moving some of these into the requirements in the standard rather than keeping them in the application material. And the other comment that I want to make is that, again, as a former financial market regulator, I would say sensitivity analysis can be very effective in producing information that is relevant to the reader of the statements. So maybe there's something to do in this area.
For reporting standard setter, you mean?
Yes.
Well, the risk of greenwashing, I see that is very related with materiality, because some point you can accept some kind of makeup, but not surgery. So I think that, again, SMPs will need help from the professional bodies in identifying this kind of topics.
Mark, you have more on this?
Three thoughts. There are different ways to greenwash, if I may. One is to hide inappropriate qualitative or quantitative information. Thanks to the new regulation and the ESRS, that will not be any more possible. So I believe this part has to be mainly removed. Second is in the looking forward information, to commit on things that are almost unrealistic and will never be achieved. On that respect, I do believe the way we assess this looking forward information is extremely important. It's not just to see whether it is communicated, it is disclosed, but if the resources to achieve it are properly allocated, financial, human resources, otherwise these transition plans clearly will never be implemented. So thoughts to be more precise probably in what is asked to the assessor when assessing this information. And other comments, as you know, there is this draft regulation in Europe for the green claims attached to products. I do believe the way greenwashing has been expressed is almost well detailed, and some words can be used also in the ESA 5000 to guide the editors on what is acceptable and what is not acceptable. And final point, when assessing this sustainability report, I would recommend the assessors, depending the sector of activity, particularly for business to consumers activity, to also look to the products and the labels and the information which is communicated on the website, etc., to see if there is no distinction between what is in the sustainability report and the assessment and what is disclosed separately. Because when we sign an assurance report, we engage our responsibility, confirming that not only the regulation is respected, the data communicated has no mistake, but also that the company is behaving properly. So I will make that recommendation to look to products and communication attached to it. Yeah.
Regarding the green claim, of course, we will have a look at it. However, we have to remain a global standard, so we cannot be jurisdiction-specific and impose EU regulation globally. But of course, that's part of the landscape. And now, maybe to conclude, and let's do it in two sentences, if we can, but it's very important. So we developed this ISA 5000 as a global standard with the aim for it to be used as a baseline for all the needs of sustainability assurance engagement. But in the EU, CSRD requires more. So there are some aspects of CSRD that are not part of ISA 5000 because they are not global. So what else would be needed in the EU to be added to ISA 5000 to comply with CSRD? I'm sure you already have a lot of ideas on that.
Honestly, no. When I read, we all know CSRD requires limited assurance on the whole. In my view, ISA 5000, in principle, can cover all of that, right? Can form a very good basis. I would personally be somewhat hesitant to adjust, if you like, a global standard to any jurisdiction, even if that's EU. Where we talked in the beginning about the materiality process, I think, yes, there can be some further guidance, so that may be some addition to the standard. But as you said in your introduction, that's the basis for any sustainability report. In the CSRD, there's another requirement to include it, of course, in the annual report, and to then you come also with reference information, etc. Again, you could include that in the standard, but personally, I would keep it applicable to all and everything, including, as you said, for example, specific sustainability-related reports and reports where you have a limited scope. So I would largely stick to what it is.
Patrick, are we missing something?
two comments on this. The first one would be to invite you to do something about electronic reporting, because this is something that is required in Europe, of course, but I think it may be used in other areas. And without mentioning ESEF or anything specific to Europe, I think you could add something there. The other thing that I would like to mention is ISQM1, which is something that is right now specific to the audit profession, and therefore I am wondering whether this is something that should be listed per se in the standard, rather than a more generic term talking about the quality management by the entity providing assurance on sustainability, for instance.
Any other elements we miss in the standard for it to be used in Europe? No?
Just to make a comment. You defined two blocks at the very beginning, the criteria and the ISA 5000. I think there is something missing in between. The criteria does not define the full scope of the role of the assessor, and the ISA doesn't do it. For example, when we assess in Europe a sustainability report, we have to ensure it conforms to the CSRD and the ESRS. This is not said within the ISA 5000. It is not defined in the criteria, so we expect it to be defined in the national regulations asking you to audit such and such parts. Probably it is sufficient, but within the ISA 5000, this element regarding covering specific requirements from regulation is slightly mentioned, but not, I believe, detailed enough. The same comment for taxonomy, which is one of the important elements, for which we clearly do not know who has to do it. Is it the sustainability auditor or is it the financial auditor? Is it both of them? How do they have to prepare these works? It's a bit still confusing. Yeah.
Well, what we call the green taxonomy and what we call the digital taxonomy that you touched is something specific to EU. So, of course, it's not INISA 5000 and probably it's something that will need to be developed at the EU level. And we will have to determine how. So maybe it's time now to move to the to a Q&A session, because I'm sure you have all read the draft ISA 5000. You have heard a lot of comments, and I see that Patrick is about to jump out of the room.
Exactly. I'm sorry, but I have a plane to catch and have to leave this room.
So it was great meeting with you, and I believe we will meet again even this week. So see you soon.